चलो अच्छा। गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ क्लास 9, वेलकम बैक टू द ऑनलाइन क्लासेस। नाउ लेट्स कंटिन्यू आवर लेसन इन हिस्ट्री, पेजेंट्स एंड फार्मर्स। सो वी आर नियरिंग द लेसन एंड एंड ऑफ द लेसन, सो वन मोर क्लासेस आर लेफ्ट इज लेफ्ट फॉर कंक्लूजन। नाउ टुडे वी विल डू how the unwilling peasants or the cultivators were made to grow opium in India. We are in the last part of that paragraph, that is paragraph 3, the last part. So now, so far the cultivators were provided advances to grow opium in Bengal and Bihar and Odisha. Most of the people over here were unemployed, so they needed job. They needed money to meet their everyday needs. So as the village headman, we can say Mahato, was providing loan, he was actually an agent of the British government. As he provided the loan, the people were, or the peasants were very happy and they readily accepted. So now, and they had to grow opium in the best soil, that also we have learned. And they had no time for other crops to look after. They had no time to look after the other crops because we have also learned that opium cultivation was very delicate and it requires long hours of tending and so on. And the prices paid for their produce was very, very little. That's why they refused advances and sometimes they were beaten up. Sometimes they were forced to take the loans. So far we have learned that. Now we'll continue of the last part of this. Number one, by 1773, the British government in Bengal had set up or established monopoly to trade in opium because other traders, local traders, were not allowed to trade in this product with or export opium from India. It was considered illegal. So now, that's why they established monopoly to trade opium. No one was legally allowed to trade in the product. So we can see that local traders were not allowed to buy or sell this product. Only the Britishers were engaged, or they had set up the monopoly to trade with this in this product. So you can see that. But by 1820, British found to their horror that opium production in their area was rapidly declining and it was increasing very fast in the princely states outside, not where their rules are, the area under the kings. There the production of opium was increasing. The reason was the local traders paid high price for the product. So naturally the people, they grew the opium. So they used to get a high price for their product and they earned a lot of profit there. But in Bengal, Bihar and Odisha, so here the peasants were not ready to grow opium because the price paid for their product was very, very, very little. Low, you can say that. So that's why it was declining in their territory, whereas in other territories, especially in the princely states, there were a number of small kingdoms that was called princely states. There the production of opium was growing or increasing. There, in those princely states, the local traders paid high price for the product. So naturally, the farmers and cultivators or peasants were very happy to grow the opium. There was no restrictions, there was no nothing, because it was not the British rule there, it was the princely state. So now you can see the British, to the British government, this was considered as illegal. Though it was not their territory, though it was not their territory, it was princely state, but British government thought that this is illegal. Only the British are allowed to trade in this product, not the Indians. So you can see, to British this was illegal. And what the British did, they appointed agents to go to the princely states to confiscate and destroy the crops. Wherever the crops are grown, you go and destroy them. Wherever you find buying and selling or trade of opium, you confiscate. Confiscate, matlab, you capture. So you can see that the Britishers were actually, they were cruel, you can say. It is not being justified because it is not their territory. It is a princely state ruled by a small king, or it was a small kingdom. But the Britishers entered there also and tried to interfere in their trade and their livelihood. This shows that the British government want to dominate the other regions too. This conflict between the peasants, local traders and the Britishers continued as long as opium production lasted, or as long as there was a demand for opium in China. So especially these, all the opium used to go to China. They used to export to China, because we have learned that most of the Chinese officials, traders, businessmen, peasants, army men, all were addicted to opium, because it was introduced by the Portuguese during the 16th century. So most of them were addicted. That's why, so as long as there was a demand for the opium, or the opium production lasted, the conflict between these three groups, peasants, local traders and Britishers, continued. The conflict between them continued. So now, the peasants all over India did not experience the same like opium cultivators. There are peasants all over India. There are farmers, peasants all over India. But other peasants all over India did not experience the same thing. Some of the peasants, they lived in the princely state, some of under British government. But the peasants under the British government, they suffered so much. But the other peasants around India, they did not suffer so much. They suffered in other ways, but not like the opium cultivators of Bengal, Odisha and Bihar. So they experienced different situations there. So now, this much for today. In our next class, we will have the conclusion, the final touch, the conclusion to be continued. So that will be the last class for this chapter, and we'll have another chapter. We'll continue. So that's all for today. Thank you for watching the video, and stay safe. Continue studying at home. Go through online portal every day so that you'll not miss anything. If you miss, then it will be a difficulty for you to understand certain things. So that's all for today. We'll meet in the next class and continue our conclusive part, the last part. So that's all for today.